Good afternoon. We'll be starting the session, Fundamental Rights. This morning we have seen right to speech and expression. And the rest of the articles, we'll try to do it today. Let me open the document for you straight away. And I will have a discussion with you regarding Article number 20 of the Indian Constitution. Look at this. This article is talking about protection in respect of conviction for offenses. I would like to tell certain points to you. Kindly listen to this. Generally, what will happen, any person, once he commits any mistake or any crime, the police will be arresting the person and the person will be taken into the custody. Immediately, the police is expected to register a case against him and the person will be produced before the judiciary. Whenever the police file any case against any person, he is considered to be an accused. Straight away, we cannot use the term criminal, but he is considered to be an accused. And the accused will be produced before the court by the police. And the court will try to conduct an investigation again with the support of the police. And after that one, the judiciary will pronounce and the judiciary will announce that the person, either he committed a crime or not. That is called conviction. Meaning, a person who is accused may be convicted over a period of time. Conviction is nothing but establishing with the proofs that the person has committed certain crimes. After a person has been convicted, he will be given the sentence. Giving sentence is nothing but giving the punishment. Punishment may be of any kind. Maybe it is a penalty. Maybe it is simple imprisonment. Maybe it is rigorous imprisonment or life imprisonment. Or it may be a death penalty. That all depends on the judiciary of the day. That all depends on the crime that is made by the concerned person. So without accusation, without conviction, a person cannot be sentenced. I'll open the document. I'll just type a few points for you so that it will become more easier for you to understand. Now a person is considered to be accused. Once accused is arrested, he'll be produced before the court. Later, conviction will be done and he is called convicted, CTED. Later, a convicted person will be given the sentence. So this is actually the procedures. Now, with this proper understanding of accusation, conviction and sentence, let us try to go ahead and let's try to talk in terms of this protection in respect of conviction for offenses. What is the meaning of this? When I use the word protection in respect of conviction for offenses, a person has to be protected even after the conviction. Just now we understood what is the meaning of the conviction. Just because of the reason a person has been convicted for the offenses, he cannot be ill-treated, but he should be provided with he should be seen even with a dignity when it comes to the conviction. And in this particular article, we'll come across with the no ex post facto legislation, no double jeopardy, no self-incrimination. Let's try to understand one after the other what is the meaning of this. When I use the term no ex post facto legislation, this is nothing but no ex post facto legislation means a person can be punished only according to the law which is available at the time of commitment of the crime. Meaning, whatever the law says, only according to that law, sentence has to be given to a person and he cannot be given any sentence which is not mentioned in the law. In India or in any country, sometimes the law will change. accordingly, the punishments will also change. That is nothing but the sentences will also change. During that time, what will happen is that the time of commitment of the crime will be taken into consideration. At the time of commitment of the crime, any particular crime, whatever the law says that so-and-so punishment has to be given, a person has to be given only that punishment and not any other person, any other punishments. That is the basic idea of the ex post facto legislation that should be absent. There is nothing but no ex post facto legislation. But sometimes we will make the laws in such a way with the retrospection, with the retrospective date. What do you mean by this retrospective date? I was telling you in the previous class that once you make a change in any law, that has to be notified in the government gazette. And in the government gazette, whatever the name that is mentioned, from whatever the date that is mentioned, from that particular date, the law will come into effect. Imagine a situation. Today is December 20th, 2014. Maybe during this time, the law is saying something called a 2 years punishment. But now you change the law where a particular crime should be given minimum 5 years of imprisonment. Imagine a situation, a person has committed the crime on December 1st or in the month of November. Then obviously, whatever the law says in the month of November, only that particular punishment has to be given to the person and the not the latest one. But sometimes we will affect this law with the retrospective date, means in the gazette, if you decide that this law will come into force with effect from so and so date, if that so and so date is the previous date, that is called a retrospective date. This is how the people will be punished, either from the date that is mentioned in the government gazette. That date may be the future date, that date may be the previous date. If it is the previous date, that is nothing but that will come into effect from retrospectively. Very important, kindly remember this. Next one, I'll open the document, have a look at here. Second one is the no double jeopardy. What do you mean by no double jeopardy? No double jeopardy in the sense, no double punishments for a single person for a single crime. What is the meaning of this? Let's try to understand what exactly is this. Single person, single crime, single punishment only. That is the basic idea. Single person, single crime, and punishment should be single. For a single person, for a single crime, two punishments should not be given. Two times he should not be sentenced. That is the meaning of the no double jeopardy. What is the basic idea? In fact, it's really a common sense point here. A person has to be punished only one time for his single crime. This is the basic idea. But sometimes what will happen is that the people, if it is not mentioned in a clear-cut manner in the constitution, the people who are there in the power, they may misuse the powers. They may misuse the power by utilizing their positions. They may try to give the punishment to a person who committed the crime only for one time. Two punishments may be given. And this was the worst experience of the Indians, especially during the time of the British rule. And in independent India, free India, the constitution does not want the people to suffer like this. Hence, at the time of framing the constitution of India, the constitutional fathers, they designed the constitution in such a way that the people will be protected even after their conviction. This is the basic idea. Okay, number one is the no ex post facto legislation, and number two is the no double jeopardy. Number three, no self-incrimination. no self-incrimination in the sense, what is the meaning of this? Self-incrimination means a person is forced to give evidence against himself. And that is not permitted under the Constitution under Article number 20. Reason may be anything, either maybe because of his personal interest or because of the pressure from anybody, he is not expected to give evidence against himself. Meaning, an innocent person has to be protected, an innocent person should be seen that he will not be punished for anything for which he did not do any crime. That is a basic idea under Article number 20 of the Indian Constitution. Kindly remember this particular point. Now, look at this. This is the meaning of the no ex post facto legislation, no double jeopardy, and no self-incrimination. Now, let me go to Article number 21. Kindly have a look at this. What is the meaning of this? Let's try to understand. This article is considered to be very, very important for us. Protection of life and personal liberty, except in accordance with the procedures established in the law. What do you mean by this? Right to live with human dignity, decent environment, privacy, free education, all these are considered to be the protection of life and the personal liberty. What do you mean by this? See, so many times this particular article will come into our discussions. You might have seen sometimes high profile people, they are arrested and they are thrown behind the bars. And every person is entitled to get the bail. But when it comes to the people with high profile, sometimes they are denied of the bails. It is because if the bail is given to them, they may use their power and they may modify the evidences that are available. That's the reason sometimes the bail may be denied. During that time, the person may be approaching the High Court or he may be approaching the Supreme Court for the bail. During that time, the lawyers who are arguing on behalf of the person who is behind the bars saying that it is a violation of Article number 21 of the Indian Constitution. This is how they will argue. Because he has not been convicted so far. If a person is not convicted, how can you keep him behind the bars for quite a long period of time? This is how they will try to argue in the court. And if the court is convinced, during that time, the court may give the bail to the person and he may be released. Okay, that is number one. Number two, Supreme Court also made it very clear that right to good environment is also a fundamental right. What do you mean by this? So the people are living in different localities. Sometimes the government may give permission to an industry to set up at some place. And by verifying various facts, various procedures, the state may be giving the permission to it, and accordingly, the industry might have been started. But maybe after a period of time, because of any reason, they will forget about all the procedures and the lots of pollution will be emitted into the atmosphere. During that time, the atmospheric pollution will be happening and the people who are living in those areas, who are living in the nearest vicinity, so they will be suffering and their health is getting disturbed and the lifespan will be coming down. And whose mistake is this? This is not the mistake of the people. This is the mistake of the management, because they are practicing low standards. That's the reason. Whenever such type of incidents are happening, the Supreme Court made it very, very clear. It is nothing but the violation of Article number 21. Similarly, the court also said that right to privacy is also a fundamental right. One cannot look into the personal life of the others. until and unless it is causing a security threat to the nation or to the society. So this is the observation that is made by Honorable Supreme Court. And in the year 2012, the Supreme Court also mentioned that right to sleep is also a fundamental right. So this happened in the year 2012. You must be knowing there is a person by name Ramdev Baba. He is considered to be yoga guru. In the year 2012, this Ramdev Baba, he wanted to start an agitation in New Delhi, and he wanted to put the pressure on the government of India so that India's money, which has been stored outside India, that should be brought back. And in order to put the pressure on the government, Ramdev Baba, he wanted to start an agitation. And it happened in the year 2012 in Ram Leela Maidan in New Delhi. And by listening to the voice of this Ramdev Baba, so many people, so they reached the venue. So he has so many followers, and the followers came to Ram Leela Maidan. And the fast unto death by Ramdev Baba has been started. He's a yoga man, you must be knowing this. So very strong, very healthy. So entire day has been happened, and night time, all the people who were giving support to Ramdev Baba, they got tired and they slept on the floor itself in Ram Leela Maidan. But night after 11 o'clock, the Delhi police, they have acted with over enthusiasm, and they have entered into the Ram Leela Maidan. They have entered into this Shivir. They have started beating the people who are sleeping. So all of a sudden, so they started receiving the lathi blows. They did not understand what is happening. By the time they realized, they already started feeling the pain. So they started shouting and they started running in different directions. And if you remember during the time in the stampede, so there was a woman by name Ram Bala. She succumbed to so many injuries, and later she died in a hospital. During that time, Ramdev Baba, so he was trying to escape, but the police have caught him, and in a special aircraft helicopter, so he has been sent to Haridwar during that time. But this particular incident has been taken very seriously by the Supreme Court of India. That is called Sumoto. Supreme Court acted on its own. After observing the whole thing, Supreme Court understood very clearly that the mistake lies with both the parties. Supreme Court pointed fingers towards both Ramdev Baba and also to the Delhi police. It is for Ramdev Baba because he did not feel responsible to try to protect the lives of the people. And being the person who organized the meeting, he himself started running away. That is number one. Number two, when it comes to the Delhi police started beating the people who were sleeping. And Supreme Court's observation was like this. Every person needs rest after a day's work. Once a day's work is over, he has to take the rest so that he'll be rejuvenating the body for the next day. And beating the people who are sleeping should be considered as a third degree torture. Third degree torture is a mechanism that was used by the police only against hardcore criminals, terrorists, and Naxalites. And these are the common people, innocent people. By listening to the voice of Ramdev Baba, they have come. How can you beat them? In that observation, Supreme Court made that right to sleep is a fundamental right. Because you have disturbed their sleep by beating them, hence you have violated their fundamental right, and that comes under Article number 21, according to the Supreme Court. And Supreme Court has imposed a fine of 5 lakh rupees on both Delhi police and Ramdev Baba. But unfortunately, one life has been lost during that time. This is how Article 21 comes into picture. And over a period of time, we have added another article called Article 21A. It talks about the right to education for the children. I'll show you the document. But whenever I use the word children here, these are the people who are present between 6 and 14 years of age. Look at this, Article 21A. Right to free and compulsory education for all the children. And see here, if you read the further lines, in fact, it was present in Article 45 of the Indian Constitution. Through 86th Amendment in the year 2002, it was made a fundamental right, and the right to education came into force on April 1st, 2010. So today we have a new article in the fundamental rights, right to freedom, that is Article 21A, which has been added with an amendment called 86th Amendment. But the concept of right to free and compulsory education, this is not a new concept in the Indian Constitution. This is very much present under Article number 45. But when it comes to Article number 45, it will be falling under directive principles of state policy. When it comes to directive principles of state policy, these are the directions that are given by the Constitution to the government for working towards the welfare of the people. When I was talking regarding fundamental rights, I told you, fundamental rights are justiciable. If I feel that my fundamental right has been violated, I will be going to the judiciary. But when it comes to DPSP, it is non-justiciable. It is up to the government to decide whether it can be implemented or not. If the government cannot implement, we cannot go to the court and we cannot question the government. And the court is also cannot interfere into these aspects. But over a period of time, the concept of education became very, very important. And there is so much of pressure from the society that education must be made a fundamental right. Otherwise, since the beginning, the government was trying its best to provide free and compulsory education. That's the reason throughout the country, so many government schools have been established. But even after so many efforts, the right to education is not reaching the people properly. It is because it's a part of DPSP, because the people are not in a position to question the government. That is the reason why the subject content of Article 45 has been taken out and it is added in the fundamental rights. It has been added through a new article called Article 21A. And since then, right to education became a fundamental right. It is a responsibility of the state to provide free and compulsory education. Otherwise, that is considered to be the violation of the fundamental right. Am I clear? This is a new concept and it came into force since the year 2001, April 1st. So this is about Article number 21. Next, let me talk to you regarding other article. Article number 22. Look at this. Look at this. When we say Article 22, excuse me. Article 22 says that protection against arrest and detention in certain cases. What do you mean by this? Kindly see here, the general thing that is present is that you have two things here. One is punitive detention. See here, I am moving my cursor here. Under punitive detention, Second one is the under preventive detention. When I am talking about the punitive detention, arresting a person after commitment of a crime. The police, just now I told you, they will arrest a person and the person has to be produced before the judiciary. But under punitive detention, a person can be arrested only after committing a crime, and that too with the arrest warrant. Once the person has been arrested, he has to be produced before the nearest magistrate within 24 hours. Within 24 hours. That is called punitive detention. When it comes to preventive detention, it is nothing but arresting a person before he actually commits a crime. This is what our security forces will be using against the Naxalites, against the terrorists. Sometimes you will come across in the newspaper that ISI agent has been arrested, SIMI activist has been arrested, but they have not committed any crime. But still they will be arrested because the police has the information that they came out. They came out with a plan to execute something. And if the plan is really executed, the lives of the people will be lost. That is the reason why they will take the action well in advance. And before committing the crime, the person will be detained. That is called preventive detention. Hopefully I'm clear. And this is what is mentioned under article number 22 of the Indian Constitution. Okay. So under preventive detention, grounds of detention should be communicated. Provide an opportunity to make representation. Right? Next. We have another article that is, another fundamental right. That fundamental right is the right against exploitation. We have two articles, articles 23 and 24. Look at this. So article 23 talks about the prohibition of a traffic in human beings and forced labor. So when we use the word prohibition of the traffic in the sense illegal utilization of the human beings. Maybe it is the traffic in human being, maybe it is the traffic in women, maybe it is the traffic in children, but using them for illegal activities is very much prohibited by the Constitution. That's the reason sometimes you will come across in the newspaper also, some women may be used for this flesh trade. During that time, the police take it very seriously and such type of organizers will be arrested. They will be produced before the judiciary and the judiciary will give them punishments. Clear? A person cannot be exploited just like that. A person's dignity has to be respected. And this is the place, this is the article which comes into the protection of the people. Next, if you look at the same article, we also have something called forced labor. What do you mean by this forced labor? Forced labor is nothing but forcing a person to work under you without his interest. It was very much existing in India during the Zamindari system. And once the Constitution came into force on January 26, 1950, the concept of forced labor has been completely prohibited. That is number one. Number two, paying a person less than what is promised is also called forced labor. That is called underpayment. Underpayment is also not permitted under article number 23. I'll tell you some more points when I come here for the detailed discussion. Now, next one is the article 24 of the Indian Constitution. Prohibition of employment of children in factories. In fact, it says that hazardous factories. Look at this. Whenever I am talking about the child, so he is a person between 6 and 14 years of age. So this is what we have seen, we have understood. Now, this is the age for a child to have nutritious food so that he will be developing physically. This is the age for a child to have the quality education so that there will be psychological development of the child. If a child does not study during this age, at what time does he study? That is the reason why the child labor has been completely prohibited in India under the constitution. But even today also, we'll come across with certain points saying that sometimes children who are working in any of the institutions or in hazardous factories, if the information is available to the government will take the action and they will arrest the people who have employed the children. Okay, so that is the fundamental right number 3, where we have spoken about the two articles, articles 23 and 24. That is the right against exploitation. In this, we have seen 3 things. Under article number, we have seen prohibition of trafficking in human beings and forced labor. Under article number 24, we have seen about the prohibition of the child labor. Am I clear? Next. Next one is the next fundamental right. Right to freedom of religion. Articles 25 to 28. Kindly remember, so this is one of the very, very important fundamental rights that is present in India. If all these fundamental, if this particular fundamental right is implemented properly, then we can call India a secular nation. India is secular because we are protecting the dignity of article number 25. Under this article number 25, 26, 27, and 28, enough freedom has been given to the individuals. Enough freedom has been given to the individuals with respect to the religion. Hence, the religious conversions are very much permitted, but forced conversions are prohibited. If a person is changing, he's converting his religion on his own, one cannot stop him, because we are giving him lots of freedom. But when it comes to forced conversions, they are very much banned. And these 4 articles are talking about the freedom of religion. I'll show you this point now. Look at this. All persons are equally entitled to freedom of conscience, the right to freely profess, meaning agreeing, practice, following, and propagate any religion. Propagation means spreading the religion. If you look at some of the TV channels in the early morning or some other time, they will come across with the concepts of this propagating the religion. So very much permitted. So we cannot take any action against them. We can propagate our own religion. We can practice our own religion. At the same time, we can profess our own religion. But the condition is that we cannot criticize other religions. Very, very, very important. If my religion is important to me, other religions are also important for those people. If I am giving respect to my religion, means I should also be accepting and giving respect to other religions. That is the beauty of the system in India. It is the country where there is high religious tolerance. We see that our religion will be existing and intact at the same time, so we don't create any harm to other religious people or other religions. Very much permitted by the Constitution of India. Am I clear? Next. I'll open the document once again. Look at this now. When it comes to article number 26, have a look at this. This is the freedom to manage religious affairs, to establish and maintain institutions for religious and charitable purposes, very much permitted. You must be knowing personally also, there are so many religious institutions. There are so many institutions which were established for the religious and charitable purposes, and they have every right to own and acquire movable and immovable property. At the same time, they also have the right to administer the property, very much permitted by the Constitution of India under Article number 26. Now, when it comes to Article 27, excuse me. Article number 27, it is talking in terms of the freedom for a taxation for promotion of a religion. What do you mean by this? Kindly remember one point. We are using a word that is called the taxation. Whenever I say tax, tax is a compulsion. Anybody who is coming under the purview of the taxation, he has to pay the tax, which is a compulsory. But the Constitution has not permitted for any religious tax. Very, very, very important. And that is what is mentioned under this particular article, and that article is article number 27. Look at this. No person shall be compelled to pay taxes for the promotion and maintenance of any religion. Very, 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 very important. Okay. Now, meaning it is telling us that religious taxes are not present in India. Look at the next one. I am talking to you about article number 28 of the Indian Constitution. This article is talking about the freedom from attending religious instruction. What do you mean by this here? No religious instruction shall be provided in any educational institute wholly maintained out of state funds. You know the meaning of the word state. Maybe the central government, maybe the state government, or maybe the local self-governments. If they are providing to any education institution, if they are providing funds to any education institution, their religious instructions are not permitted. But religious instructions are permitted if it is established by endowments or trust. Look at this article 28, class 3. No person attending any educational institution recognized by the state or receiving aid out of the state funds shall be required to take part in any religious instruction that may be imparted in such institution or to attend any religious worship that may be conducted in such institution or in any premises attached thereto, unless such person or if such person is a minor, his guardians have given his consent thereto. What do you mean by this? There may be any education institution and that is receiving the funds from the states, but in that particular one, you cannot force a person to go for any religious worship in that institution. And if the person is a minor, without the permission of the guardian, you cannot do all these things. That is what is mentioned under article number 28. This particular one is protecting the religious, the people not to practice the religious education which does not belong to them. I'll just give you some one or two examples. After some time, you can have a look at this. Next one is the right to culture and education. So again, these are mentioned in two articles, that is article 29 and article 30. Right to conserve language, script or culture. Look at this. Article 29 grants protection to both religious and linguistic minorities. Kindly remember this, very, very important here. And remember, when I am using the word minorities, minority is the word which is against the majority. For example, if you take the religion concept, Hindus are majority in number, the remaining all groups are considered to be the minority groups. And recently we have also included Jains in the minority groups. Okay, Hence, this particular article is giving protection to both religious and linguistic minorities. Very important. Linguistic means what? Language. Look at this. When it comes to Article 30 of the Indian Constitution, it talks about the rights of minorities to establish and administer educational institutions. Look at this, which is highlighted one. All minorities have the right to establish and administer educational institutions of their choice. Very, 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 very important one. This is how the Constitution is giving protection to the culture and educational rights. Okay. Today, kindly do one thing. Because of my other schedule, I had to stop the class in between in the morning, and we have finished articles starting from article number 12 to article number 30. It is just the overview. And tomorrow morning when we meet, I'll talk to you regarding constitutional remedies. And for tomorrow, I request all of you to please be ready by 4:45. I'm very sorry, I'm changing the timings here. 4:45, only for one day. Because tomorrow we are going to have a session for 45 minutes. And I think that will be enough for me to complete article number 32, which is considered to be heart and soul of the Indian Constitution. Apart from that, I'll also tell you some more points. Because again, 5:30, I'll be stopping it and I'll be going out. But from day after tomorrow onwards, we'll stick to our schedule. We'll be starting the class at 5 o'clock. But only for tomorrow, please be available by 4:45. So once this particular topic is over, from day after tomorrow, again, I will revise the whole fundamental rights, article by article. Is that okay? But before that day, I request all of you to revise this fundamental rights topic one time, two times, three times, or four times, as many times as you like. Right? Accordingly, if you go like this, the concept on the fundamental rights will be completely understood to you, because it is going to be one of the important areas in the examination point of view. Okay, so I'll stop at this stage. So thank you so much for being with me this afternoon. See you tomorrow at 4:45 a.m. Thank you so much.